This next segment is really important to me because I grew up with Captain Planet. I had two choices in my household. It was to watch PBS or Captain Planet. My mom had a rule with us. We had to watch educational television. So this show had a great impact on my life. Like any good executive producer, went back to figure out, are there any connections that Planet Ford's had in the past with Captain Planet? So I go and Google this on our website, as one would do, and I found one reference where somebody had said, it was a question of, tell us what your friends think you do for a living. And the person wrote that I lead an effort that's like a modern day Captain Planet. And when I looked to see who wrote that, it was me. And I forgot I wrote it. So anyway, this was a really important show to me growing up. I know it had an influence on me. I think that's why I'm standing right here. And well, we're so lucky to have you here today, Laura. But just to give you a flavor of what this show looked like, we wanted to show you a clip. This is a Planeteer alert. And please pay attention to the messaging, because we're having a little bit of the same conversation we were having. I want to say this clip's maybe from 1991 or two. That we're having today. The effort has obviously changed, but you can see how this show really drove some of the conversation. So, Jeff, if you have the clip, let's roll it.
Go, Planet!
You can recycle just about everything.
Like plastic. It's practically indestructible and stays around forever.
But scientists do have ways to recycle many kinds of plastic.
Still, recycling starts with you.
Technology can do many things, but it cannot make our garbage problem disappear.
Only you can make less trash. And remember the three R's. Reduce, reuse, and recycle. The power is yours!
All right. So yesterday we had Tom Zaki, and he's trying to make garbage disappear. We're all trying to do the same. So this is part of that effort. So I'm going to turn it over to Frank and Laura.
Before I bring Laura up, well, no, Laura, come on up, come on up, come on up, come on up. Let's put Dan back in the middle. So have you meet many Captain Planeteers around?
Yes.
Yeah?
A lot.
When did you watch this? Like, was there a day?
Well, no, my brother and I would, we had to watch it. It was on TBS or TNT in the afternoons, reruns, and that was it, so.
Test him. See what he remembers.
Oh, please don't do that.
I already did, and I
failed miserably, but so I do remember the theme song. It's probably the catchiest theme song ever.
I was going to ask, are there any other Planeteers in the room that watched the cartoon growing up? So it's like, Captain Planet. He's our hero.
I'm not
gonna take pollution down to zero. Okay, well, anyway, we gave up on that.
We have no place to go from there.
No, I just can't sing. I don't want to.
And I'm a wannabe millennial. I'm actually a baby boomer, unfortunately.
Yeah, well, that's good. Well, so we will take your inspiration and see where Laura.
I will say Kwame was my favorite character. He was voiced by LeVar Burton. So in my PBS world, he was reading Rainbow, and then the Captain Planet world, I had LeVar Burton again.
So interestingly enough, Kofi Annan, the former Secretary General, God rest his soul, he took Dad to Ghana, which is where Kwame was mm-hmm. from, and at the King's Palace, when my dad was introduced, they mentioned CNN first, and they mentioned that he started Captain Planet, the cartoon, second. So I was like, wow, that never happened again. But anyway, Captain Planet, the cartoon, was so big on the African continent, and especially in Ghana, where Kwame was one of the characters.
That's awesome. Yeah. Awesome. We're lucky to have you.
We are.
Thank
have
you.
A seat. Thanks, Dan.
Thank you.
Oh, wait, Dan, before you go, can I just have a shout out to Dan and a flip flop? All right? I mean, what you are experiencing these few days, all right, Dan and Kim and Hannah and Dylan and our planet, a tiny little Planet Forward team has put together an amazing event. So, Dan, thanks to you.
Thanks for being here.
So, hi.
Hi.
I'm so glad you came here.
I am too.
All right, who knows who her father is?
Captain Planet.
That's true. That's true. What's his name? Ted Turner. So I just so you all know, in case you don't, I worked for Ted Turner. Actually, Ted insisted we say we work with Ted Turner, right?
Yep.
For 21 years
at
CNN. And the Captain Planet sensibility, the sort of environmental sensibility, came over. I mean, we had an environmental, CNN had an environmental unit, reporter. You probably don't know this, but I was a White House correspondent, and the job I was going to do coming out of the White House, you may not know this, was going to be the environmental affairs correspondent until mm-hmm. Tom Johnson called me and said, I want you to anchor instead. But that's what I wanted to do. So tell people about where this kind of sensibility came from. Where did this start in him and in you? Because this is your life now. This is your passion.
Well, it was Dad's idea, but it basically came from his relationship with a gentleman named Dr. Lester Brown, who founded World Watch Institute, and he wrote a book, a very important book, every year called State of the World. And it was about how the population was growing and how resources were being managed and the loss of biodiversity. A lot of it was pretty negative. And Dad's like, oh my God, you know, and Gro Brundtland, the former prime minister of Norway, also had a report come out called the Brundtland Report. And so Dad's like, you know, we don't have decades to thwart this problem that these people are talking about and their research and their reports are saying, so we gotta get on it. And he said, well, you know, I have my media platform. He had the Superstation. And he said, you know, Saturday morning cartoons are it. You have a captive audience. Now there's no, you know, they ended Saturday morning cartoons and they're 24/7. Thanks again to my father who said, let's give them what they want, cartoons 24/7. But, you know, he's really well known for putting the vision back in television. And it wasn't for money's sake or for marketing that he started Captain Planet. It was really to develop a cadre of environmental stewards in youth who are empathetic and compassionate, have a can-do attitude, and would go out there and change things in their homes, their schoolyards, their communities, to create a better planet.
I'm curious, how many in the audience watched cartoons? So everybody.
Yeah.
So this the cartoon Captain Planet, talk about how that came together. So it was it like, let's just do an environmental cartoon, or was it built around
super? Well, he really wanted to leapfrog the schools, the education system, because the schools weren't teaching environmental education. So he said, you know, Lester, we can just take this straight to the kids, you know, on Saturday mornings. And it was a very award-winning and very profitable cartoon.
It was a profitable cartoon?
Yes, it was. It had everything that you can imagine as far as merchandise goes. I mean, shoes, backpacks, games, water testing kits.
Oh, things that were sold from the cartoon.
Yeah, right. And so, you know, Dad said, well, you know, let's take some of that money and invest it in, you know, in a foundation that would make grants to educators so that kids would have an opportunity for hands-on environmental activities.
So yesterday, Caitlin Yarnell from National Geographic was here, and we were talking about the idea of impact in storytelling. Mm-hmm. What do you want your impact to be? Mm-hmm. And she was talking about the audience of one, and sometimes they will do documentaries literally that's designed with the president of a country in mind, so the president sees that and preserves land or something like that. What was the impact that you had in mind, or that your dad had in mind for Captain Planet? What were you trying to accomplish with that?
Well, first of all, Captain Planet was the first and only eco superhero. And, you know, to compete with all the other superheroes, Batman and Spider-Man and all of that. And then he wanted to add in youth as a component, because if youth could see other youth, especially that looked like themselves, because the Planeteers came from five continents, so it was a very diverse group and part of the success. And so it was really the Planeteers working individually, but then when they worked collectively, they brought the power of Captain Planet to life.
So for those who haven't seen this,
hard to explain.
What, yeah. The Planeteers were what? Explain what the Planeteers were.
Well, the Planeteers were five youth from five different continents, one from the U.S., Eastern Europe, Russia, Asia, and South America.
And what were they up against?
Well, they were up against really devious eco-villains. Sly Sludge and Duke Nukem, Dr. Blight, Hoggish Greedley, and so it was really important that the that the eco-villains were not a corporation. That
you
they
did that on purpose? That was intentional?
It was. Because? It was because it represented the environmental issue or the social issue. War, landmines, AIDS, deforestation, loss of species, water pollution, air pollution, all of these different issues, even nuclear power
issues. You didn't want to demonize.
And you know that the Planeteers never used violence against eco-villains. They never punched them, kicked them, shot them, blew them up. It didn't happen.
What's left?
Can you imagine having a cartoon where
right.
that doesn't happen?
Right.
So it showed the importance of negotiation. And actually, like we want our world leaders to do, you know, to work together to solve these big problems globally. But there were 113 episodes. They were seen in 100 countries, in 23 different languages. Everywhere you go, there's Planeteers. There were 80 million in this country alone. About 600,000 of them are on Facebook. They have their own Facebook page. And
today, still.
Yeah. So, you know, I can have a conversation, and by the way, the reduce, reuse, recycle, you could tell that was age, because we know that there's a fourth R, and what's the fourth R? Refuse. Refuse anything that's one use, throw away, especially plastic, right? Okay, so the interstitial needed to be updated, but there were 100 of those interstitials, and they were all original and using the Planeteers, but would give kids the idea after they just watched this great cartoon about an issue of global importance, how they could make a difference in their own community, in their schoolyard, in their home.
So there was a deliberate effort to sort of engage them in mm-hmm. activity.
Mm-hmm.
And how did you do that? How was that done? Was that done did you have teaching guides that
went
to
schools? Oh, well, that had nothing to do with the foundation. So those were the two legs of the strategy. The third leg was the foundation. And the foundation,
Captain Planet Foundation.
Yes, took the merchandise sales, profits, and residuals, and actually granted that out as small grants to educators in every state in this country, in 29 other countries. And so it was just a re-granting program initially, but we've developed many other great programs, like our Captain Planet Learning Garden. We have about 1,500 gardens, 300 of them in Atlanta, which is the home of Captain
and what
Planet.
Is it? What is that real garden? What does that mean?
So it's a learning garden. So they're about $3,000 a piece, which is very reasonable. Which we raised the money to deliver those to schools. But they have all standards-based curricula, so an educator can teach all subjects in the context of the garden, so not only science, but math and history and social studies and art. Then there's a mobile kitchen cart, which has an induction burner, age-appropriate salad making equipment. We're partners with Vitamix, so the kids, what they're growing in the garden, they're super excited about. They can prepare it and taste probably and very likely their first plant-based meal. I know Marco likes that, right?
Where is Marco? Is Marco still in the room?
And needless to say, we teach the trainers, so we train the teachers. We have an online training resource, so in case they forget. And then we also help them with their summer garden management.
Now, in the cartoon, in the program...
And that's only one program,
yeah,
by the way.
Well, we'll come back to some others, but back to the cartoon for a minute. You enlisted some pretty big names for your voices and your characters.
Mm-hmm.
So talk about how you engaged the celebrity community for this.
Well, so when Captain Planet came about in the 80s and 90s, the first great environmental movement was in the 60s with Rachel Carson.
Right.
The second one was in the 80s and 90s.
Well, and we had Earth Day was established in
the
70s.
Well, in the 70s.
Which we're coming up to the 50th of that. Right.
Right, but with all the research coming out
right.
and technology,
right.
it really was the advent that, you know, more and more people knew about the challenges. So there was a lot of excitement among these A-list celebrities, and they wanted to lend their name. They did get paid. They all got paid exactly the same, like $600. That was it.
$600?
$600 for doing the voiceover of the...
And who are some of the celebrities?
So Whoopi Goldberg was Mother Earth, Gaia. You had Ed Asner, that was Hoggish Greedley.
Jeff Goldblum.
Jeff Goldblum, who was Sly Sludge. You had...
when he's not Mr. Fly, he can be Sly Sludge.
Yeah, and you had, let me think, Meg Ryan was Dr. Blight. I mean, there were a lot of really big names.
Did you hang out
Even
with
Elizabeth
them?
Taylor did a voiceover for the episode on AIDS, because it wasn't only about environmental issues, it was also about social issues.
Did you hang with them when they were shooting
no.
the show and doing the
No, voiceover? Unfortunately, that's I didn't
too,
hang with
that's
them.
That's too bad.
I was in Atlanta, you know, Hanna-Barbera was making the, Deke made the first couple of years of episodes, and then Hanna-Barbera, that Dad acquired, as part of the company, and the, then the CEO of Hanna-Barbera said that he did not like Captain Planet, he didn't believe in it, and he, what was the other thing? And he didn't believe cartoons should have messages. But, and you know, the guy from Deke, the head of Deke that made the first two seasons, he was with his son, and they ate their McDonald's meal, and then the dad threw it out the window, and the son's like, get out of the car, Dad, you're making the Captain Planet cartoon now. So, I mean, you know, it's like, It's the impact was really rather significant. Wherever I go, if I'm on an airplane and I'm talking recycling, the flight attendants, you know, said, "Oh, I watched Captain Planet growing up." I was just in Santiago, Chile, and I met with the mayor, and the chief of staff actually watched Captain Planet growing up, and then
and
Chris
and
Helms
recalled that and recalled that and talked about.
Oh yeah, yeah. Most definitely. He watched it in Spanish. And he said a lot of stuff doesn't translate exactly the way that it should. And the song was kind of funny in that language.
Captain
and then in case you didn't know, Georgia's become like number one for making movies, which is phenomenal. So all the Avenger movies are made in Atlanta. And Chris Helmsworth was there making his most recent, and he's Thor, you know, and he's a superhero, not an eco-superhero. A lot of superheroes blow up the world. They make, you know, more pollution and more devastation, and glamorize that. But he watched Captain Planet growing up in New Zealand and could sing the theme song.
So we've talked here about, you know, my bumper sticker for stories is compelling characters overcoming obstacles to achieve a worthy outcome. That's certainly what the Planeteers were.
Mm-hmm.
How did you try to make, and thinking that these, and you're all storytellers, right? You're thinking of your audience is kids. So what made those Planeteers compelling? How did the storytelling, how did you try to make them compelling, interesting enough so that people would care about them?
Well, I mean, I think that they were relatable. The youth were relatable. They dressed in kind of hip of the time outfits. They came like Wheeler was from New York and loved to skateboard. I mean, it was like Mati was from the rainforest. He was actually the youngest Planeteer. He was 12 years old. And each one of the five Planeteers had, you know, they represented an element. So it was earth, wind, water, fire. And they didn't have a number five. So it was heart, because kids have heart. And as I said, empathetic and compassionate and a can-do attitude. And they're not biased. They haven't seen or you know, they haven't been bought out per se, and so I think that was part of it, and the fact that they were working together, five kids from five different cultures could come together and solve problems to help. You know, it's like think global, act local. So they were doing the local work, but then they came to the Planeteer Alerts, and it was all about local, and then the Captain Planet Foundation funded them doing hands-on environmental projects that educators wouldn't otherwise be able to offer. And now we know that place-based and project-based learning and education is the bomb, and that's where you want to go. And that ties in with STEM learning, which is what everybody's focused on. And actually, earth sciences attract more diversity. So not just white boys, but so, you know, when kids are designing, the white boys are designing robots, underwater robots, all of a sudden we would give a grant to the educator, and she can expand the offering to other students. And you have these girls and students of color coming in and saying, oh, well, we have to redesign this robot because we actually have to put a camera on it and it has to go seek and find the plastic pollution so that we can go and clean it up. And so that's kind of like, I think, the spirit of the Planeteers.
That's great. Talk a little bit about the Captain Planet Foundation that goes on. So the show, the program, has been out of production for several years, but the foundation goes on under your leadership.
And another thing, thanks for reruns, you know, because it did air on Cartoon Network. I'm not sure if it's still there, but Boomerang, the graveyard for all great cartoons like the Flintstones and Looney Tunes. But every episode, basically, you can see online, like you can see everything, so it's great. And what was your question? I'm sorry, I keep...
The foundation.
Oh, the foundation. Okay, so we just, we have the school gardens, which is super critical because kids have to get over their fear of dirt, germs, and bugs, and eating vegetables, and educators have to get over their fear of getting kids out of the classroom and into the schoolyard. And then also we have eco-STEM kits focused on renewable energy, watershed management, pollination, and soil health. We have eco-tech grants, so there's this big debate between green versus screens. So don't get the kids to put down the technology, get them to use it for good, like the underwater robots. And then we just created an Ocean Heroes boot camp, which had an amazing response. We worked with about 800 youth from 11 to 17 years of age, and they came to New Orleans for World Environment Day last year. And then we gave them 3 days of just intense, like, how do you scale your game? They came because they care about ocean plastic pollution and what's happening to the marine systems and, you know, the plastic pollution everywhere. And then they go home and they scaled their game. So there were kids that went home and they got their school districts to ban one-use throwaway plastics.
So they went and they were activists. They were taking this and doing something in their communities.
Right. And we partnered with 7 aquariums around the world. The next one's in Vancouver in June. And we're partnering with 25 aquariums. So it's simulcast, because it's hard for kids to come from, you know,
sure,
Australia,
sure,
and the UK. But technology is so great that way.
Right, right.
You know, it makes it possible.
And I should say, you also, you attend a ton of conferences, and you are
a
presence, and you give awards. So you all enjoyed Tom Zaki yesterday? Yes? Yes?
We gave him an award.
I know.
And actually, Sven Lindblad has been very generous and donated trips for our auction for Captain Planet. And then Steve was telling me, who we're going to hear from next, was that his son, who's 31 years old now, grew up watching Captain Planet, the cartoon.
So I want to talk about how this becomes a sort of a culture, in a way, of storytelling. Your father, Ted Turner, I worked for Ted when I was at CNN for many years. And really what got me into this project and into this mindset was a documentary I did when I was at CNN called We Were Warned. And it was We Were Warned Tomorrow's Oil Crisis. And it followed Hurricane Katrina, because I saw Hurricane Katrina slam into the sort of the Gulf in those areas. And we had at the time about 25% of our refining capacity is in that area. So you have a Category 5 hurricane, takes that out. And in this documentary, we actually posited, okay, let's say you have a hurricane, a Category 5 hurricane, it hits. And at the same time, bad people someplace else in the world decide to launch a terrorist attack, you know, on a major oil facility in Saudi Arabia. What would happen? So for me, that interesting overlap of applying imagination and intellect, I thoroughly researched these scenarios. And we danced between the scenario and what we're doing today to avoid it. And I visited, for part of this film, I went to the deep waters of the Gulf to look at our drilling there. I went to the oil sands of Canada, tar sands, depending on how you feel about them, what you want to call them. But I also went to Brazil, where 40% of the transportation fuel is from sugarcane ethanol. Mm-hmm. And I went to Detroit and looked at hydrogen fuel cells, so we could look at both sides of the equation. Your father, I think, brought this. He insisted at CNN that we be thinking like this. Mm-hmm. Would you talk a little bit about that and how you heard him speak about this? Because it really extended across his media empire.
Well, I mean, he always looked at the challenges that we're facing humanity and tried to do well by doing good. And, you know, he obviously started CNN and he put war in people's living rooms for the first time ever so that people would know what the atrocity of war looked like and would say, no more, no more. We're going to, you know, rise to another level and put war and hatred and animosity and division aside. He started, he always says that there are three biggest challenges to humanity. One is global warming. One is the first one was the threat of nuclear weapons. And he said it will get you in the short term. The second one was global warming, and it will get you in the long term, but the long term is now. So, you know, these two things are neck and neck. And the third one was overpopulation. But he started the Nuclear Threat Initiative, as you know, and that's celebrating 20 years. Sam Nunn, former senator from Atlanta, who was very focused on this issue, is still very involved with that organization. You have the UN Foundation. You know, since he was a boy, he was a big fan of the work and the peacekeeping abilities of the UN. And so he gave an unprecedented amount of money to the UN.
$1 billion.
$1 billion. It's true. Yeah. And it turned out to be a great part of his wealth because of the AOL takeover, you know, and we won't get into that.
I remember it well.
Yeah. And so, but he also gave money to Jeffrey Sachs for the Sustainable Development Solutions Network. And they did the Sustainable Development Goals. And he said that that is the business plan that we all need to look to save humanity and be more compassionate. The CEO of Coca-Cola was speaking the other day at a Chamber of Commerce event, and he said, you know, if the world consumed like Americans did, we would need a couple of extra planets.
It's true.
And we don't have them, so what are we going to do? Are we going to keep consuming like we do in the U.S., or are we going to consider, you know, the billions of people who are living at the edge of poverty and try to create a more just, equitable world for all? And I thought that, and I should be talking about Ted, but, you know, he's done it all pretty much.
And you're carrying on. I mean,
I was really sad to hear my whole family's, my immediate family is vegan, plant-based. My husband, my three kids, I was about 90-10, but I just went over the edge because of a film called, actually two films, but one's called The Game Changers, and when it comes out in September, you've got to see it. And the other one is by Simone Friedman, who produced it, and it's called Eating Animals, about factory farming. And that will do it for you. Those two films, and of course, you know, what we heard. Yeah. Marco talking about.
A couple of questions from the audience. For we'll go right to the back of the room there. There's a mic on the way. Please stand. Tell us where you're from.
Hi, I'm Rebecca Parsons. I'm at the University of Georgia.
Go Dogs.
Yes, go Dogs.
I didn't go there, but my husband and my daughter did.
Yeah, and so I grew up my whole life in Atlanta, and I love the city. And have you read City on the Verge or heard about it at all? It's a great book, but anyhow, for cities like Atlanta that are kind of moving towards that greener, more sustainable city, but aren't, I think, quite as far along as other cities, what do you think is important for citizens and natives of Atlanta to do to push it towards the direction it needs to go?
Well, my son's the sustainability director of the city of Atlanta, and I'm just so glad that he watched a lot of Captain Planet and Planeteers, I have to say, but you know, he's doing a great job. He's been there for a couple of years. The old mayor hired him. The new mayor kept him. And just before Al Gore came to Atlanta like 10 days ago to do his climate reality training, city council for the city voted unanimously on the plan for Atlanta to move to 100% clean energy by 2035.
Wow.
So it's significant. And I would say Atlanta, there's a new National Geographic that's just out called Cities. The title is Cities, and Atlanta is featured prominently what we're doing in there. And we are a top-tier city of sustainability. And our new mayor cares about the justice and equity piece. And, environmental justice, climate justice, our poor communities, underserved communities in Atlanta, you know, we're really focused on solving the food desert problem, very committed. We're the first, and I don't know, only city, but first city to have a director of urban agriculture that's going in and changing city lots and making, they call them grow a lot. So they're, giving them out to urban growers to farm, so there's fresh food right there to sell to the community. So we're hitting it on. And if you want to see the clean energy plan, it's online now, so you can see what we're doing.
One of the things we've been talking a lot about is communication and storytelling, right? And I think that this is a great example of where there are going to be a lot of opportunities for you as communicators and storytellers. Cities across the country, communities, corporations are moving in this direction more and more. They're going to need qualified, skilled, imaginative, creative people to communicate with their citizens, with their constituents, with their stakeholders. Don't you think? I mean, I think there's going to be much more opportunity because this is a growing field with a growing demand.
Yes, and just like all the great movements of the past, suffrage and the civil rights movement, it's like the hockey stick and then it hits this, trajectory. And global warming kind of looks like that too. Scary, but you've got the gay and lesbian, LGBTQ,
yeah.
Thank you, movement that's hit that, the plastic pollution awareness and pushback, which is happening now, thank God. And I think, people are banding together. When you look at, the sunrise movement, those are millennials and younger that are speaking up about climate and going after bad people in public office that are climate deniers and disrupting things. You have the Children's Trust, where Chitez Martinez and 18 other under 18 youth, so they can't even really vote, but they've sued the Department of Justice and oil companies, and that's progressing. You've got Greta Thunberg, who's a young Swedish, 16-year-old Swedish girl, who's done these sit-outs, and I think there were 1.6 million youth from 100 countries that sat out on March 15th and didn't go to school because they were, they've become climate activists.
Sure.
And it gives me chills just talking about it.
Yeah, it's amazing.
And just about before I run, I want to make sure that I get this in. So Leo DiCaprio bought the rights to make the Captain Planet live action full feature film. I can't imagine that there won't be any punching and kicking and blowing up and all of that. But I'm really hoping that he brings this theme and these messages to the next, the next generation.
Yeah, and film. This side of the room, question for Laura, in the back.
Hi, my name is Mark Mine. I work with U.S. Green Building Council. My colleague actually works with John in Atlanta. Let me ask a storytelling question.
That's my son, John. actually, we call him John R.,
I'm trying to start a campaign here locally called Waste Watchers, which educates people to engage their local restaurants and retailers in a conversation about zero waste. So I would love to hear your perspectives about how do we use social media to to impart that story to businesses, and what message should we be relaying to the general public to help compel them to move in that zero waste direction?
Well, the National Restaurant Association has an environmental sustainable component. I don't know where they are right now, but we worked with them. Our family foundation actually gave them money to kind of build out a whole sustainable education component on their website and how-tos for restaurateurs and chefs and what have you. But we have 49 restaurants, but we serve meat. We also have a lot of vegetable options, but we're going to have more vegetable options, I think, coming, plant-based options.
I think we ate some of those vegetables when you and I last dined at Ted's Montana Grills.
Exactly. But, you know, we've been in business for about 15 years now, and we committed to being 98% plastic free. So we have never had plastic straws. We have paper straws, and we don't automatically stick them in the drink. We kind of tuck them over in the corner on the table. We, you know, save water. We changed out all of our light bulbs a long time ago. Some of our restaurants have solar panels. We recycle everywhere we possibly can, but there is a crisis with recycling. The wheels are coming off. And even though in certain cities like Atlanta, you know, we've got the recycling partnership is, and Coke is one of those. But if you look at the mainstay of the companies that make up the recycling partnership, it's like the oil companies and the plastic bag producers. And, you know, and it's like, this is very strange. But what we can do to really help is just not use the stuff in the first place. Because there's too much of it. There are too many people. We're using way too much of it. It's, you know, going away. There is no way, and it's really a bad thing. China banned our plastics and paper, and now India's just banned our plastics, which was a significant.
The stuff that, right,
they will not allow us to send our recycling to them because it's so contaminated. Do y'all have the labels, the Recycle Across America labels on your bins here that make it easy for a 5-year-old child to go up to bin and know exactly what goes in there? That's part of the solution. Bottle deposits are one. Bans and fees are another one. And those companies listed in the recycling partnership, none of them want to do those things.
Right. We have time for one more quick question. We'll come over to the side here. Very quick, please.
Sorry to get off on a tangent.
Oh, it's not. It's fascinating.
I'm a plant.
Hi, I'm Evan Bernard. I'm from the University of Georgia. Huge fan of Captain Planet.
We did our climate reality training together.
Yes.
There were 2,200 people in the room.
Yeah, it was fantastic.
It was like two capacity, very diverse, 600 youth. A lot of the faith-based community was there. Civil rights leaders. It was amazing.
Go ahead.
Right, so I was wondering...
And I'm sorry, but as quick as you can.
Yeah, if you could talk about how Captain Planet Foundation is working with young individuals and maybe supporting them as well, not just the educators.
Well...
Or if they could in the future.
Well, we work primarily with schools and educators in schools, so they apply for the grants to make it possible to do these different programs. But the good thing about it is that we also work with informal educators, you know, as far as like nature preserves and Boys and Girls Club, so they get our gardens too. The EcoSTEM kits, they're like an average cost of $500, but we give grants for those. So educators have, seven different lesson plans that are standards-based that they can do much more comprehensive than just giving a teacher a one-off grant for one specific part of a program. And, you know, all of these have design engineering components, field studies, citizen science projects. I mean, that's the way that we roll there.
That's great. Mm-hmm. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Before I turn this back, should we share what we're doing together?
Sure.
You think so?
Yeah, go
ahead.
I haven't
run this by Matt Canella or my...
Oh, just get yourself into trouble.
Should we just get in trouble?
Just get in trouble.
We are working to honor Ted Turner in a profound way here, and this is actually the public announcement of this. We are going to create at the George Washington University the Ted Turner Professor of Environmental Media and Communication. And
yay!
And this is an amazing opportunity for someone, when we get done with our campaign to raise the funds to do this, to teach you and generations forever about how we deal with this and communicate something that will be a challenge on this planet as long as there are human beings. It just will. So I'm very excited about it. I am unbelievably grateful to you and to your father for all that you have done. Ted Turner changed the world. He changed the world, and he will continue to do so. So thank you so much.
Thank you.
Anything you want to say to future Planeteers?
I wanted to just say my two favorite episodes of the cartoon, and I haven't. The first one was about Haga Screedley and the Planeteers battling, but there was offshore oil rigs, and this was in 1990, the first episode where it kind of blew up and just polluted everything with oil, and boy, did we see that with the BP oil spill. And right now, we're kind of battling that with our administration, right, opening up these special places, and there was a big win the other day that that banned, drilling in the Arctic, which is a big deal, right? And then the other one was called 12 Angry Animals. We are in a massive biological die-off right now, and if you saw it, it's not funny, but it was a snow leopard that took the Planeteers up to this mountaintop where there were the judge and the jury, these 12 angry animals that were endangered, and they put the Planeteers on trial, and they couldn't really put the Planeteers in jail because it wasn't their fault, and the Planeteers were fighting on their behalf. But just so we know, because a lot of young people get that we have to have livable, walkable, sustainable cities, but we have to remember all these endangered species out there and make sure that we're advocating for plenty of land and resources for them as well. Thank you.
Thank you, Laura.
Oh, and as Captain Planet would say, go planet and buy our powers combined.
All right.